You did not get into this as a. You did not grow up, or did you grow up going, God, I want to make movies with aliens and things.
Not consciously, no. Because it was not a career path. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously, people were kind of doing it.
Right.
Films in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. You know, Nosferatu and all the B films, horror films back mm-hmm. in the 50s. It was somebody had that job. But it wasn't a career path. It wasn't a school you could go to.
Right.
So yeah. It was a hobby. It was something fun that you would do. You'd draw monsters, and that was it. I was a fan of them. But honestly, it wasn't until really when I moved back from Switzerland that I said, I'm going to somehow break into this career and try and become a creature designer.
So what were you doing in Switzerland? Were you making
teaching?
Cuckoo clocks? No?
That would have been a great thing, though, if I was doing actual like creature design in Switzerland. Ironically, one of the people I consider to be the king of creature design is from this area of Switzerland that we were in, which is H.R. Geiger. Yeah, he is, in my opinion, still the king of the icon of creatures, which is the alien.
So you were teaching, what kind of teaching were you teaching?
It was industrial design primarily. My business partner, Scott Robertson, and I were teaching illustration, rendering techniques, but also design classes, automotive, product design, advertising.
So you were interested in movies, but you kind of went to school for engineering and...
That was my education was industrial design. And I went to school originally with the intention of kind of following the footsteps of people like Joe Johnson, who had an industrial design education. So it seemed to make sense that if I wanted to do something like Star Wars, that I would get an education in that field.
Right.
He went to Long Beach, but the Pasadena Art Center was close by, I mean, mm-hmm. blocks away. So I went up to the campus and saw the gallery, which was unbelievable. Mm. And it was, at the time, since the gallery changes subject matter, it was aircraft, hypothetical military aircraft, like sci-fi, basically. And I was sold. I just wanted to do whatever it was that they were doing. So I entered the ID program at Art Center, fortunate to be accepted. And as I got educated as an industrial designer, mm-hmm. I started to drift away from doing film, or at least the idea of doing film, because
right.
I just love the craft of industrial design.
Hmm.
So when I graduated and Scott graduated, we decided to start a design consultancy in San Francisco right out of school, which is pretty rare to do.
Hmm.
To actually have the courage or stupidity, depending how you want to look at it, to start a consulting firm, two guys mm-hmm. fresh out of school. So that's what we did, and years later, that was 1990, we've been doing it since, so it's worked out.
So you came back from Switzerland and with the idea that you wanted to get into the movie business? Or?
I kind of jumped ahead. Both Scott and I went to school in Pasadena, got educated, worked up in San Francisco Bay Area for a few years, and then like 94, went to Switzerland because there was a teaching opportunity. So we kind of finished
so
the projects.
You went as a team?
Went as a team.
Wow.
Yeah, we were inseparable. People wondered.
There
but
you go.
We went there and taught at the school for a couple years. And when the school sadly went out of business, we came back to L.A.
And then, was that what you hoped for, was going to Switzerland and being professors?
It was never on the radar, no. Huh. You know, you roll with the punches and the opportunities. And that was an opportunity that was presented to us by one of our instructors that we had at Art Center. And it to this day, it's one of the best things I've ever done for myself, from just a personal standpoint, but also in terms of my own continued education. If you're going to teach, you're forced to really know your subject matter, at least you should. And both Scott and I took it very serious, and we really worked harder and studied harder than ever before to really hone the skills so that we could actually pass them on in an intelligent way.
So I thought it would be the skiing or the chocolate, but it was actually that you had a...
I didn't ski once.
Really?
Yeah, but I ate a lot of chocolate to compensate.
Okay.
But no, I'm not a skier. It's almost embarrassing because people assume... I went up to the Alps.
Mm-hmm.
I was on the Matterhorn, so it's got to count for something.
So then that ended of its own volition.
Yep, school ran out of money, and they had to shut down, so we came back with our tails between our legs. Boxes of chocolate.
And said, okay, let's try something new? Or
pretty much, yeah. We came back, and Scott was
living... Do you guys have parents who, like, think you're crazy? Is that...
No, not at all.
I mean,
actually,
it sounds like you guys repeatedly kind of, like, take these opportunities to change and do things that are
I think
pushing your own envelope.
The only person that may have thought I was a little, maybe Mashugana was my mom. You know, she would have preferred initially that I had kind of a straight and narrow path, a kind of an obvious route, mm-hmm. where there might be a tie, there might be a jacket.
Which engineering might have been.
It might have, yeah. But I deviated, yeah. And, you know, medical products look hopeful for a while for her. Mm-hmm. But then going to Switzerland as an educator, that still carries, you know, a bit of clout. Mm-hmm. And especially a teacher in Europe, it's a whole different respect than, obviously, here in the States. Mm-hmm. But they've always been supportive, but always with kind of a, you know, one eyebrow raised, like, okay, you want to be a monster designer? All right, you want to be an actor? Okay.
But you were a grown-up when you say, I want to be a monster designer.
Sadly, really.
It's
yeah.
not like you were 20 years old still. You were had to be 30 by that time, it sounds like.
Yeah, I was mature enough to have it really make no sense. Yeah.
And so how did you go about making this real?
The monster design parts?
Yeah.
I've always kind of dabbled and doodled, and it was fun. But I really wanted to do it as a career. And I knew of some people that were doing it professionally. Mm-hmm. So when we came back from Switzerland, we were teaching also at the Art Center in Pasadena. So mm-hmm. when the gig ended there, we came back, started teaching at the Art Center. And through that, there was a gentleman named Phil Hedema, who was the head of entertainment design at Universal Studios mm-hmm. Here in L.A. And he had mentioned to Scott that, you know, we're designing a whole new ride called Men in Black, the ride, Alien Experience. Mm-hmm. And I thought, if we can get that, there's a bunch of aliens, and I dug the stuff that was in mm-hmm. Men in Black, so this is fantastic. But they said, we want you to design the vehicle, mm-hmm. because you guys are industrial designers, and you know wheelchairs, since that was kind of a good thrust of our work when we first mm-hmm. graduated, was medical products. Mm-hmm. Ambulatory aids. So they needed a vehicle that would be able to accommodate wheelchair users and the disabled. So I was like, that's great. And if that's a shoe-in, well, throw me a bone and please let me design one or two creatures. And it evolved into doing like more than half of them. Mm. And the greatest thing of all, honestly, was the fact that when I started to design the creatures, they said, we're going to give you the bulk of this, but you're going to mm-hmm. need more people to help you out. So we can recommend someone who's helped us up to this point and mm-hmm. in developing the property, and he would like to continue developing it with you. Mm-hmm. His name is Carlos Suante, and I thought, great, never heard of him, but mm-hmm. Bring it on. And Carlos, to this day, it's kind of like there's Geiger, as I mentioned, who mm-hmm. is a huge inspiration to me and mentor, unbeknownst to them. Carlos as well. He's a phenomenal talent. And at the time, I recognized that he had skill, but I had no reference point
right.
in the world of creature design. And my crew that was here was Carlos Suante, James Cagle, who's a veteran in the industry, George Ushel, who's a phenomenal designer, the molding department, mm-hmm. which is really critical, because if you do a sculpt and somebody does a bad job molding it, you got to start over. Mm. And there's a whole talent to that. And I had just the most incredible department in general, it mm-hmm. felt like, but I had no idea that I had kind of like the A-listers in the studio. So my education as a creature designer mm-hmm. could not have been more fortuitous. And basically, it was the best guys that I was just paying attention to what they were doing, not realizing I was getting the best education imaginable. Mm. So it was pretty phenomenal. And it set the tone for how I work, I must admit.
So from how did you get your first film from there?
From there, during that project, another guy that was working with us, I should have mentioned his name, there was quite a few, Jose Fernandez, who is an unbelievable artist. He has his own company now. Mm-hmm. And he was sculpting here, but he was working on some project down a couple studios down from us. Mm-hmm. And one day he came back here and left his keys over there. So a woman came knocking on our door and she said, I hear Jose's working with you and he left his keys. It's like, oh, okay. And so she's poking around looking in here and she sees that we have a bunch of helmets. And mm-hmm. she said, do you guys design helmets?
Yep.
Yeah, we've done that. Interesting. We have a job that might be helpful to have somebody who does like real helmets, real industrial design helmets. Mm-hmm. And she said, the job is, first of all, my name is Colleen Atwood, and the job is Minority Report. with Tom Cruise. And it's like, sounds interesting. Absolutely. So both Scott and I got involved designing initially some costume stuff with Colleen, helmets, the jetpack that they were wearing. But there was also a need for bicycles, futuristic bicycles, and some other props, including Tom's three-finger gloves. Mm-hmm. And with our experience, particularly Scott's, in the bicycle realm, having worked on production bicycles, we started to develop some of the bikes for the film as well. So we did a lot of prop stuff. Mm-hmm. And although that was like the beginning, sort of working in film, you kind of have to be in the union to work on the front end of film, which is in some ways more interesting to me because I like to establish the look of a film, the vibe of a film, where the back end, which I've been content with, working with Rhythm and Hughes and other visual effects companies, you're taking what has been established and evolving it a bit further.
Right.
So that was kind of the first door to open, was Minority Report.
And when did you get the first thing that you could actually make your own from the beginning?
Well, you know, truth be told, the answer would be there hasn't been any.
Huh.
Because it's so collaborative. Like, Super 8, I was the only creature designer on Super 8.
Right.
But it's JJ's script, his story, his invention, his idea. And he didn't have a design in mind at the beginning. You know, when he and Steven and I sat down day one to talk about what the creature could be, there was no sketch necessarily, nothing really specific at all, just the narrative points that had to be hit.
Right.
So from that standpoint, yeah, I had a great deal of ownership of how to influence JJ, but it was showing him broad strokes, many, many different variations on a theme. But all the while, he is navigating and directing to the end result. So from to go back to your original question, I can never say that I take full credit for any one thing that I've done from start to finish. I may have been the one who held the baton all the way through from start to finish, but you're always being art directed to some degree.
And when you're sitting down with Steven, it's just you become jaded to Spielberg walking in the room and just kind of like, hey, Steve.
I think I made him a little nervous, if that's what you mean.
Well, you obviously got to spend time with him on Minority Report a bit.
A little bit. And more actually on Men in Black, The Ride.
Interesting.
Because obviously him being executive producer, we had to pass everything through him. So there was a big pitch that we did. And that was the most exciting day almost to date. Because I'd never met him before, and it was like at the first... for me, that was the first real celebrity. Actors, although celebrities, it's the filmmakers that are going to make me a little more jaw-slack than the actual actors. So meeting Steven was pretty incredible. And to actually be in a very small room with him intimately, it was myself, Phil Hedema, and Dave Cobb, just really the four of us. And it was right before the new release of Star Wars, Star Wars Episode 1. And Steven had just seen it a couple days before. So sitting there, having Steven talk casually, matter-of-factly, about George and the new technology in this Star Wars, and it was just so bizarre to... I don't think I said a word. I may have wiped my mouth a couple times, you know, from drooling. But it was such an exciting moment. And then because of that immersion, then you're not over it, but you're able to be a bit more professional and focus on the job at hand.
And that's when he asked you to do the Jar Jar Binks for the Men in Black ride, and you...
And that's when...
And then canceled it.
And that's when I was busy.
Cannot do the Jar Jar. Sorry.
No, fortunately, that didn't show up.
So how involved were you with Cloverfield? Because that's one of your credits also.
Yeah, yeah.
So was that Munster less yours, or...?
Same as Super 8, really. Almost identical. I was... the lead creature designer under production, and same thing, JJ knew that he wanted something big in scale, and he knew there were certain story points that we had to hit, including that he knew, because it was so huge of a creature, that the fear was going to be a little detached with regards to the intimacy of the creature. It's so big that its toenail is the size of a bus, and when a toenail is coming at you, that's just not going to be scary because you have no context.
You didn't see my toenail, so clearly.
I'll put your toe against my dad's toenail. Maybe that could be my first movie.
Toenail.
Toenails. Thinking about it. But
Bat Thumb. I think somebody did one of the Oderkirks did a thumb movie. So
it was good, and I think it was all in camera.
Yeah,
if not mistaken.
No CG in this one.
None.
No but fingernails were harmed in the making of.
The creature, the parasitic creature that falls off of the main creature, Clover, that was an idea that JJ had that solved the problem of the intimacy, which was a really cool idea. And together we kind of collaborated on what's the most appropriate thing to come off, why would it be there in the first place? Mm-hmm. So that is where we kind of really discovered we have a great rapport with one another in terms of how we collaborate. Mm-hmm. But he did let me go. From the very beginning of, it's got to be big, and that's about it. So
is it strange designing for a character in both cases where not seeing it for a substantial portion of the movie is part of the gag?
No, I think it's a good thing because that's the way you get audiences to be more titillated by it. You know, the suspense of not showing it at the beginning. Mm-hmm. I think there are ways to feed it maybe more slowly throughout the production. Mm-hmm. But then again, it comes down to personal choice. Right. I always feel like they should show more of the creature, but that's mm-hmm. because I want the movie to be about the creature.
So is there a line between anatomy and industrial design when you're dealing with an alien being?
If I think the short answer is no, there is no line, because the structure, the physics behind limbed skeletal things, and even those that are not, mm-hmm. that mechanical structure is identical to the man-made structures such as backhoes and forklifts, you know, anything that has a pivot and an actuator, whether the mm-hmm. actuator be a muscle or an hydraulic cylinder or a pneumatic cylinder. Mm-hmm. And if you know that muscles work like pneumatic cylinders, mm-hmm. then and if you understand the basics of the physics behind it, it really gives you an opportunity to start to bend the rules and twist things. Mm-hmm. It's when you don't know enough about physics and zoology and biomechanics that strange things start to happen in the end resulting aesthetic, and then worse than that can be what the animators are stuck with, mm-hmm. is this real strange biomechanical layout that once they start to make it walk, they say, hey, you know, your foot to ankle to knee ratio is a mess. And it's a challenge because there's a reason why horses and dogs and cats and every quadrupedal animal has a real similar layout and proportion, mm-hmm. you know, keeping a kangaroo out of the mix. And they have a certain movement and gait as a result. Mm-hmm. So when you choose to make physical changes to proportion just for design's sake, and it could look cool as a static image, mm-hmm. there's a reason why things work in nature. So when the animators go in and start to rig and make it move, that's why you end up with creatures that look like they're walking in thick mud, is because mm-hmm. usually the biomechanics, the look of it might be cool, right. but the biomechanics don't yield an actual huh. plausible gait. And that's an important thing that is difficult to balance, breaking the mold, mm-hmm. breaking the rules, but still maintaining the plausibility of how the mechanism would work.
Well, it's funny because you kind of came into all of this around the same time that the idea of those things being animated really started to take off. I mean, it really was mechanics and molds and parts of the body and things like that up until really just before you got into all this.
Yeah, it was definitely the physical, practical effects were the popular route, because CG, the technology was there because there's plenty mm-hmm. of films that had it. And I feel I'm fortunate to have entered a time when the CG is so good now. Every day it seems to be getting exponentially better. Mm-hmm. It's so good that now the focus is no longer on, from an audience perspective, wow, that's cool to look at because it's moving and it's relatively integrated.
Right.
You know it's CG, namely because you just know that that could never have been built as a practical thing.
Right.
But now, since you can make anything move and look realistic, the onus and the focus is on doing really good design. So in the same way that in the 50s, excuse me, you could have an Ant-Man with crab claws, chasing people around, and you bought it. The suspension of disbelief was, it was a little smaller back then, but now audiences are so much more savvy, not only about man in a rubber suit syndrome, but also about what just doesn't work biologically. It's intuitive. We know what works and what doesn't.
Well, it sounds like you have a responsibility as a designer also to the people you're working with who are going to animate the character, whatever, to come up with something that actually does work.
I think you do. And I think it's oftentimes an oversight is to not think of the importance of what you're doing at the beginning as you're satisfying the person who hired you. But with a broader vision of knowing that, yes, JJ, Steven, I know that you guys have to ultimately be happy with it, and they understand that they have to deliver something that audiences will be happy with, and I'm thinking that step as well, is that I'm supposed to be more aware than the client as to what's been done and what's out there. So I got to go through the database of creatures that are past, present, and even future productions if I'm able to find out who's working on what. And then you have to think of the other aspect too, which is an odd way to work, and one has to be very careful. But yes, you have to be mindful of the animators for two reasons. One, if you give them a crap design that just doesn't work, it's going to be irritating, and ultimately that's going to come back to you, and that's never good. But also, not that this should be the goal, but it's a byproduct. If you do a great design that your client likes and that you're proud of and you really put your energy into it, the probability of it being interesting to the people down the pipe, so that they're engaged in it as well and they're digging it.
And they're doing better work as a result.
I think so. I truly do. That because they're getting something that they feel is cool and fresh, it's a little more interesting for them to kind of take it the next step as well. And I got some feedback from ILM when I delivered Super 8, which I call Cooper, just because it's a code name. And for me, it is essential that Steven and JJ liked it, of course. And it means a lot to hear their praise.
Right.
It means a tremendous amount when the audience feels like they got their money's worth and they had a great experience. But then there's when you're preaching to the choir, you're speaking to designers and other people, and ILM sees a lot of stuff. So when I hear from them that we're really excited about this design, we love it and we can't wait to start doing what we do to it, that's a very important thing. I shouldn't say important. It's great if you can have that happen, and it really feels good because you're that audience is critical in a wholly different way than the consumer.
Right. Well, it's funny because we're sitting here at the table, actually. Maybe the camera can move around a little bit even. But we're looking at your design, one of your designs for Avatar, which...
Well, there's these guys.
There's more guys.
Ironically, the very, very beginning of the production, I happened to just have these out. It's almost like you're looking at kind of, maybe 5-6 months into the production. Maybe a little bit longer. You know, the first 4 months were at Jim's house in Malibu, which was not too bad a gig.
Right.
That was so abstract. Talk about being disoriented in the context of working with someone who is your hero. You know, meeting Steven the first time was crazy. And then meeting Jim that first day at his house. I mean, just having him sit across from you, and it's a familiar face. It's kind of like you've been looking at the Leaning Tower of Pisa ever since you were a kid, and then you're standing there going, wow, that's really it. But yeah, seeing Jim tell us what the story is about and what his goals are, you know, once you get over that, you realize you got a job. And, you know, obviously Jim, he knows how to draw, he knows how to design. It's a scary thing when all of a sudden you've got a white piece of paper, and now you gotta go, and you're at his house. He has no escaping.
Yeah.
But after doing a lot of pencil work, because Jim really didn't want to go into digital, he didn't even want to go into clay. He really wanted to stay on the board, totally traditional, which is kind of a cool, I mean, it makes sense because you can't compete with a pencil in terms of speed.
Right.
A quick gesture, and you can tell whether or not that's worth pursuing. You know, Jordu, he is kind of a rare breed in terms of speed and efficiency in 3D. He's one of the very few people that can sketch quickly in 3D, but Jim didn't want to spend any time unnecessarily.
Right.
So then when we got a chance to jump into doing it 3D, it's important because these designs were so, the goal that we set for ourselves, which was having it be more streamlined and automotive in a sense. Mm. Jim did say that at one point, I want these to be like hot rods with almost the same kind of graphic design language of stripes. And the description, I started to take almost too literal. And the Fairyverse creatures I was drawing were very much my ID background. It was planar shapes, et cetera, et cetera. And it looked kind of bad for quite a while. But that is the point of trying to break, crack the nut of this idea that Jim had.
Right.
And I had an epiphany with one sculpt in particular in the cabinet, which was a pure exploration to communicate this idea of automotive-like forms mixed with organic. And then out of that came an old study of the Banshee. I mean, you can see this sucker is, it is rough. There wasn't the time for us in-house to go in and make polished clay models.
Right.
It was, I mean, and there wasn't the intent either. It was about a sketch. It just happened to be in 3D. And then we shifted from this to ZBrush, which was sculpting digitally. And also treating them as initially sketches, but eventually they became the final asset that we would deliver to Weta. And Weta, you know, they just did a couple little things to them. Yeah, just a couple things, like made them incredible.
So is there a point where you, it gets all mixed up in a blur? It's, you're just kind of contributing into a hole that ends up being something that you don't expect even? Or do you kind of know exactly what's coming when you see it all put together and it starts coming to life on a screen? Or
it's a good question, because oftentimes I think it's more that when you're a designer in a big team and you're not following something all the way through. Yeah, there's times when, I would say, for example, Prometheus, which I'm on now, I'm happy that I'm detached from it and just focused on one aspect because I really want to be able to see the movie and be surprised. So I'm like intentionally not wanting to see any of the dailies, see any of the stuff that's finished shots. Nothing's finished yet at this point, because I want to have that same experience I had on the first Alien. But with Avatar, that was impossible because obviously I was very, very close. And when I became the lead creature designer, which meant I was spearheading all the creatures and not design, but taking them through the pipe, communicating back and forth with Weta, I had no choice but to be in many, many meetings where Weta's sending back previs, animation tests, texture tests, lighting tests. So I got to see it all the way through. And from that standpoint, no, there wasn't a whole lot of surprise with seeing it on the screen. But it's a great education and a very important one too, if you're going to evolve your career as a designer who manages the production in that aspect as well.
As much fun to be in that role as...
You know, for me it is, because I do like working with teams of people. I do like collaborating with other artists. And I also do like, I find that my part of my responsibility to the client is to make sure that what they like in a sketch is what they're going to get at the end. And Jim really set the tone for that process, because, you know, clearly Weta has a major influence on the film. But what Jim did not want to have happen was he didn't want any design to not be complete before it went to Weta. And by complete, I mean the design is done.
Right.
These had a lot of graphic design on them with stripes and so on. That all had to be done conceptually before we delivered the goods. So what that meant was that Jim knew that what Weta is going to yield in the end is a refined version of what he approved.
Right.
Versus we do a sketch, we pass that to a whole different department of sculptors, traditional sculptors even, and they will have to interpret that sketch.
Right.
And they might even infuse their take on it as well. And the word that Jim used quite often during the production was, it's deviating, it's drifting. Drifting was the word. And that meant that what he liked at the beginning, even me taking one of the designs I was doing in a drawing and starting to do a sculpt of it, he would say, "You're drifting. That's not what I wanted." I was like, "Oh, that's right. I thought I was making it better." He says, "Don't make it better. Make what I approved."
Right.
And then when you take that and have it scanned and then turned into a digital model, it can drift even more. So the point is that I like to be involved with the production start to finish, so that the client is guaranteed that the original vision is maintained throughout, with not necessarily one artist doing it, but one person who is maintaining the original choice.
Well, it's an interesting thing with Jim, because he gets such a rap for being, you know, a tough guy, but at the same time, you to do the things that he's done and does, you kind there's somebody needs to be dad, you know, somebody needs to be the one, the enforcer, and make sure it is staying in that line. And a project that huge, it's got to be incredibly challenging in and of itself, besides being the artist who's creating the visuals, you know, vision as well. It's quite a remarkable thing.
It is. It's a misconception I think people often have about tough bosses, and Jim is a tough boss. Not an unreasonable one, but he is tough. Mm-hmm. And it is because, A, you've been hired to realize his vision. It's his story. It's his idea. And at the very beginning, it was his money. So, yeah, you might want to listen to Dad. And he also has the experience and the chops to guide you. And you just got to trust that, you know, he made decisions that we didn't all agree with at one point, and then you see how it ended up on the screen, and you go, oh, he saw the bigger picture, and I was focused on the minutia, which was my job.
And on Prometheus, you're with another lightweight.
Yeah. Yes.
Ridley hasn't done much of anything. It's such a short career.
Mm-hmm.
So is that equally intimidating, differently intimidating?
You know, I won't say that any of them are intimidating as much as the expectation that I put on myself to deliver for them is what it's about. It's like, I've really got to turn up the volume now.
Of course, in this case, you get to also touch on the hem of the Geiger garment as well.
Well, and that would be alluding to it being the alien film, which I can't say. But, I mean, clearly, if we're doing a film that's outer space and has the quote-unquote DNA of Alien, you can't help but reference Geiger's stuff and even talk to Ridley about it, saying, "How did you want me to do Geiger?" And he's like, "Let me tell you what I want you to do exactly."
Right.
And I can't tell you what he told me to do. But you know, the George Lucas experience was being a kid and watching Star Wars, and then shortly thereafter seeing Alien, which I still consider to this day to be a perfect film. You know, keeping in mind that the technology has changed and you can get maybe better visual effects, but it's so well written, so well crafted, directed. The score is amazing. The creature design is amazing. It's the performances are incredible. The directing's incredible. It's one of those movies that I didn't realize at the time is the reason I am doing what I'm doing, and is why I have aspirations to direct and to develop IP, because I just love the big picture.
So that was one of the those creatures that was in pieces, and I guess it was when they were doing Aliens versus Predator, the first one, that they realized they had to come up with a way of getting the thing to walk in one shot and had the first time to really re-engineer.
Yeah.
And I'm sure it's probably been done again, you know, how she walks.
Yes.
So that it actually could be done without a suit or without, you know.
Well, and to ADI, Amalgamated Dynamics Incorporated, to their credit, they got Jim's Queen Alien to walk, and they went full on sticks and cable puppetry, which, you know, was brilliant. When there was a little bit of CG back then, but it was, you know, the post-Tron kind of digital, and certainly not the power to be able to make a real living organism. But they did just an amazing job with standard marionette puppetry.
Yeah.
You've probably seen that in the DVD extras when they had that rough prototype out in the parking lot. God. And it's horrifying as like bags and sacks and sticks.
There's something beautiful about that whole period. And it's an interesting thing because it's almost like there's something about that time where you had to do that.
Yeah.
You know, most famously the shark in Jaws that never worked. But they worked just enough and he, you know, ended up making a movie around it. That there was something beautiful about that too. Whereas now you can go all these places you never could go before, but you know, in some ways you miss the old put it on a stick and make it go boo.
Yeah, I agree. You know, that you do a digital model. I mean, I do both physical, practical models, and I'll do the digital. So I have a good understanding of the benefit of both. Digital is not quicker at the beginning, but it gives you, it expedites the process on the tail end, because variations on a theme, colors, whatever, there's no molding, no casting. know, chemicals, you might live longer. Maybe not. I sit at the computer so much more now. Before, at least, I was physical in the shop. So,
yeah.
But the there's no fighting the relevance of a physical maquette on the table. That's mm-hmm. You can put it on the screen and have it moving around, but you have it in front of you. And this just happened recently. I have created Cooper for Super 8 in the mm-hmm. computer for so long, and we're just now working on making a maquette, possibly just for the studio. But I printed out a piece of it just the other day, mm-hmm. and all of a sudden it was relevant to me. I was like, "Nah, this is cool. That's the real thing." So I hate that it almost like steals the thunder out of digital modeling.
Yeah.
But again, it's to me these are tools. Digital modeling is just a tool, albeit a pretty amazing one.
Mm-hmm.
And it's Mac versus PC debate kind of thing, or whatever your favorite sports team mm-hmm. is. It's like whatever. Yes, digital versus clay. There's benefits of one over the other, but I think you have to know both before you can have an intelligent debate.
And Green Lantern, which you did, it really was a seamless integration of characters that never made sense, you know, 10 years ago, 5 years ago.
Yeah.
It seemed almost like that was impossible, and you really don't even think much while you're watching it about these characters being so clearly not human.
Yeah.
It's kind of remarkable.
It's incidental. It's just happening in the background.
Was that the goal? Millions of dollars. Was that the ambition of that? Or?
I can't speak for Martin on that. I really don't know what his ambition was. Like I was saying earlier on, because now CG can do so much, and because mm-hmm. we've seen so much, and the attention was on, let's make the most amazing creature, the most amazing moment, it's still kind of there, but mm-hmm. I find that directors, and I think this is a good thing, and writers, are putting the emphasis back on story. It's mm-hmm. like, we can do anything now with visuals, and audiences are no longer really impressed,
right.
because it looks so real, what's to be impressed with? So you're left with only really two things now, say three. One of them is the design of what it is you're looking at.
Mm-hmm.
Not the fact that it's lit and integrated. That's kind of expected now. It should not look like it's fake. It just should be perfect. So you're looking at the design of it. Then the second is the story. Mm-hmm. It's important that it has context from a narrative standpoint. And then the third in regards to, say, animated robots and characters like the Na'vi mm-hmm. And creatures. It's about the performance, how mm-hmm. best they are performing, whether it's the physics of them looking like they're actually swinging from a vine properly,
right.
or that they are emoting in a way that we get. And, you know, the work that Weta did on Avatar is kind of unbelievable when you think about it. It's in terms of the facial...
Right. Because the creatures emote as much as the actors.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's gorgeous stuff.
And I'm assuming there was nobody acting those, you know, your characters.
There were moments when we attempted. Yeah, there was a guy who dressed up as a banshee sort of and did some performance, and it was informative. It did actually help, but it wasn't motion capture for the creatures.
Mm-hmm.
But it did give Jim an opportunity to see a human being, as well as Weta, because it was all videotaped,
right.
to see that human being pretending to be a banshee and responding to somebody, and how this actor would interpret how a banshee might, because it's a wild animal that's coupled,
right.
And it's a different context. Mm-hmm. So rather than having an animator generate some stuff, Jim felt that it'd be good to have somebody perform it initially that would mm-hmm. then inform the animator how to evolve that.
And you don't want to perform it yourself?
I've done a bit, not as a performer,
right.
but like with Cloverfield and with Super 8, I will at least walk the walk in the literal sense
mm-hmm.
of this is what I envision the creature moving like. And I might just videotape it and send it off and say, mm-hmm. he does something like this. And obviously there's physical limitations to limb length and so on. And but at the same time, it's one of the things that's too often happens with creature designers. They're not allowed to follow through mm-hmm. with the thing that they've been so intimate with that they know and probably have, they can even smell it in their mind's eye.
Mm-hmm.
You can mm-hmm. smell what the creature is, you can feel the weight of it because you've been doing so much time with it. That you probably also understand intimately how it does walk.
Mm-hmm.
And it might not be what the director wants in terms of the performance, but at least
right.
I feel that the creature designer should be involved up to the point of handoff and maybe critiquing the digital dailies. But that doesn't happen very often.
So it's not, but it sounds like you've been with directors who are open, more open to involvement.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. It's and that comes from being appropriately vocal about it to them, to say, you know, it would behoove you if I stayed on a production, which might sound like it would behoove you to keep paying me and have me hang around because it's cool. But it is, in fact, a very important thing to communicate that I know this thing very well. And it might just be features. I mean, you look at this guy, even though Jim, it was a mandate of where the teeth are here, laying down, and on his right side, they're up. There may be many other features. It could be just simply this little slit on top, which is a nostril. How do those work? Do they open up? Do they move quickly? What is the intention? Cloverfield had these things under its arms, which were essentially a serratus tracheal entry to the lungs. And if I hand off my designs without a package, but preferably a phone call to walk them through it, they're going to miss out on all the features that you basically, you're designing your object with enough stuff that the director can move his camera around it and still have things of interest without peppering it with, you know, gratuitous organic things that have no relevance.
So is it still as much fun as you thought it was going to be? Is it more fun? Is it getting better?
It's definitely as fun. It's harder. It's definitely harder because when you first start out, you start doing creatures and designs that are like on the surface. Those are the first ones that you're going to do that come to mind. And as you start to dig deeper and you start to, I won't say run out of ideas, but you start to not be able to use the typical ones that you would do, your well of resources gets a little lower and you got to fill it up. You got to basically, you've used that book in the library, I better buy another book to inspire me. So it gets more difficult in terms of how do you one-up yourself. And I've been involved with productions that are not quiet productions. They're very, very high profile. So it means that people have seen the Leonoptrix, seen the Banshee, seen all the stuff in Avatar, and there's toys and books out there. And then Cloverfield, same thing, whatever else. So each creature that you do has to be better, at least that's the goal, than the previous one, which in itself seems like that's the wrong thing to do. It's like, should I make it better than Avatar? Because Avatar is supposed to be great, but you know, you evolve and you get better, and so do the rest of the creature designers of the world, and it's now a global market. They're doing incredible things too, so you have to be savvy and open and inspired and cognizant, and that in itself does start to become intimidating when you see that it's just so much more difficult to design the infamous request, something that I've never seen before. It's a tall order, I think personally impossible to begin with, but it's getting more and more difficult to do something totally innovative. And the other challenge to that is the story that you're working on, and is the director and production designer, do they want something that innovative?
Right.
Because a lot of creatures are basically, it's a head, it's a muscular body, two arms, two legs, some kind of claws, and something else that makes it a bit different.
Right.
The Rancor versus even Cloverfield versus Godzilla, you know, the list goes on and on and on. They're all fundamentally the same type of organism.
Right.
It's just different proportions and different surfacing. So now
that it's funny how it's like the emotional connection to those characters has something to do with that. I mean, I think with the Emmerich Godzilla, I think part of the disconnection was it was so real and it was so not human that people didn't connect it with it emotionally the way they had with Godzilla for all those previous years.
Yeah.
You know, it's an interesting balance.
Yeah, it is. And that's not really the creature designer as much as it is the script and the post CG animation work. That's where you got to let go. Because if you're not doing the animation, you've got to trust that whoever is doing it. And they, you know, to be fair to them, I've been very fortunate. They will make or break a creature design, good or bad. They can take a good CG house, can take a not so good creature and really make it good because they can animate it, they can light it properly. And sometimes you have to actually work around bad creature design with better lighting. It's just the nature of things. You know, Jaws, not that it was a bad design, it just didn't work.
Yeah.
So how do you work around that? And then if you have a good creature design, let's say it's a great creature design, it could die a very early death if the CG isn't good, if it's not integrated, and if it is not animated well. So my career hinges on the efforts and the talents of post-production, because they make or break the look of what we do as creature designers. And I've been very fortunate that they have taken what I've done and brought it to a whole different level.
You seem to be doing okay.
I think it's an understatement. Very happy with where things are going, and yeah, I'm very fortunate that I've had the inspirations that I mentioned at the very beginning, my mentors and teachers, and Scott as a mentor and a teacher as well. It's been fantastic, and to be involved with J.J., Spielberg, Cameron, Ridley, Joe Kaczynski, you know, these directors are, you know, they're not, there's a lot you can glean off of hanging out in their presence.
Yeah. Looking forward to Ava 2?
I am. Yeah. I don't know when it's going
to
start.
But who knows what they'll ask you to do for this one?
I have no idea. Actually, I have no idea, which is kind of neat.
And nobody will ask you about Prometheus ever again, I'm sure. Are you going to Comic-Con?
And I will never say anything about Prometheus ever again. As I did once, I made one reference to a totally disconnected thing that Ridley talked about on the first Alien movie. And by having referenced that, it was turned into, Ridley's going to be doing this in the second one. So I'm like,
Are you going to Comic-Con? Do you do Comic-Con?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So is it just like, do you feel a wave of love when you go? And
I do. It's because I dress up like Princess Leia. I shave head to toe.
Wow.
No, I...
We all want to pay to see that. Get Hall H ready.
Nobody knows me by face, I don't think. So it's, I can walk... I'm not like Spielberg walking the halls of Comic-Con.